This video is brought to you by Squarespace.
Is this finally happening?
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? Starship could be only days away from launching. NASA and SpaceX book a WB-57. The next lunar rover is revealed. NASA selects the next four astronauts to go around the moon since 1972. Stay tuned and let's dive right in. Starship updates. We are in the final stages of preparation before SpaceX launches Starship 24 on its first orbital test flight. Teams have been working non-stop around the clock. Last week they still had much work to do, but the progress made since is nothing short of mind-blowing. On March 29, 2023, SpaceX used a pair of robotic chopstick arms to lift Booster 7 atop the orbital launch mount, OLM for short. Booster 7 was mounted for what is presumed to be the last time before the first orbital flight test. Sitting on a 143-meter tall launch tower, the robotic arms seek to revolutionize the concept of rocket recovery and integration. So much for the short story. The chopsticks are positioned beneath the rocket's load-bearing points. They can lift either the booster or Starship off the transport stand and onto the OLM for stacking and, hopefully, one day soon catch a returning Starship or booster. The lift of Booster 7 leaves just one more task for the chopsticks before the orbital flight test. This test will send Starship on a suborbital trajectory for a controlled soft landing off the coast of Hawaii. Once the chopsticks are used to stack Starship 24 on top of Booster 7, they will be stored and await their next task after the orbital flight test. If this concept can continue to be successfully implemented, it will open up new possibilities in space exploration. So much for that. What do you think? Is this the final time Booster 7 is stacked on the OLM? Let me know in the comments. I'm eager to read your thoughts. After a quiet Friday night, things started to pick up as teams prepared to roll out Ship 24 to the OLM. Chief was up late to capture this amazing shot as it began to move. The road was scheduled to be closed for 3 hours, starting just after midnight Central Time, despite rollouts usually only taking about an hour. This allows the team some extra wiggle room in case unforeseen issues arise. As expected, rollout to the launch pad took about 60 minutes, arriving at the launch site early Saturday morning. After Starship 24 rolled out to the OLM, SpaceX took the transport stand used for Booster 7 and rolled it back to the production site since it would no longer be needed. The transport stand is designed to securely hold the booster in place during transportation and allow for safe and efficient movement of the booster from one location to another around Starbase. This is an excellent sign that SpaceX plans to keep Booster 7 on the OLM leading up to the orbital test flight. All the pieces needed for launch are now at the pad. All this is breaking the excitement scale right now. The Y Studio is rotating. Now let us talk about the orbital flight test for a minute. There have been two new marine warnings issued for two separate water landings. Booster 7 will land in the Gulf of Mexico, simulating a return to the launch pad and chopstick catch, while Starship 24 will return for a splashdown off the northeast coast of Hawaii, also simulating a chopstick catch. At the same time, it is important to note that SpaceX is testing the return of both Starship and the booster over water to discover any issues that may need to be fixed. This will ensure that the launch pad or tower won't be damaged, which is said to be more complex to build than Starship itself. Those windows are open daily from April 6th through April 12th, but could change based on the timing and details surrounding the FAA's launch license being awarded to SpaceX. More on that later. Booster 7 successfully completed a propellant cryo test, also known as a wet dress rehearsal. WDR for short. Chief captured this fantastic time-lapse as the liquid methane and liquid oxygen were filled into the booster. It has two separate prop tanks that hold the cryogenic propellants. The liquid methane, also referred to as CH4, is loaded into the bottom tank, while the liquid oxygen is loaded into the top tank. This arrangement allows for the natural pressure of the propellant to flow downward towards the engines during ascent, which reduces the need for additional pumps and plumbing. Due to the extremely cold temperatures of the cryogenic propellant stored within its tank, visible frost and ice on the exterior of the rocket can be seen.
This is a common sight, mainly during the fueling process where the ambient air temperature is much higher than the temperature of the cryogenic propellants being loaded. A cryo wet dress rehearsal is important for many reasons. One of the most notable is system validation. During a wet dress, you are able to verify that all systems on the rocket are performing nominal and identify any last-minute issues. It is always better to catch the problem on the ground than to encounter any issues mid-flight. We finally have our first real indication of a target date range for the Starship orbital test flight. April 10th was the first sensation. This looks like it's slipping to the 17th, as Cameron County is now referring to the April 10th to 12th range as non-flight test activity. It's important not to jump to conclusions, as this is just a tentative date range that could change at any moment, but this feels a little different than past target dates. The Federal Aviation Administration Air Traffic Control System Command Center. That's a mouthful. Also known as the FAA ATC SCC, issues advisories like this one to provide information about events or conditions that could impact the national airspace system. It's crucial for organizations like SpaceX and the FAA to work together to ensure that the airspace and launch activities are coordinated effectively and safely to minimize any potential risks to public safety. Now, all we need is a launch license. Here's another thing. NASA has reserved a WB-57 aircraft for imaging on April 10th and 11th. And the speculation suggests that it might be for the SpaceX Starship orbital test flight. However, the date is just a placeholder, and it's important to note that nothing has been set in stone yet. What we do know is that a WB-57 will be in the sky when Starship finally launches. And Jared Isaacman approves. During the 1960s, the WB-57 was a crucial test platform for the Gemini program, a precursor to the Apollo program that successfully sent humans to the moon. Over the years, the WB-57 has played a pivotal role in scientific research, like investigating the effects of solar flare on Earth's atmosphere and mapping the planet Venus. In addition to the scientific capabilities of the WB-57, the aircraft's ability to operate at high altitudes makes it a valuable resource for imaging Starship on ascent. The use of the WB-57 for imaging the Starship launch will provide valuable data to SpaceX and hopefully some amazing pictures to the public. In the early morning of Wednesday, April 5th, SpaceX took another attempt at stacking Starship 27 atop of Booster 7. After a 24-hour delay for what was presumed high winds at Starbase, conditions improved overnight, allowing SpaceX to proceed as planned. Despite conditions improving, it looked like a dangling cable could have interfered with their first attempt around 7:30 a.m. Central Time on Wednesday. After about an hour of remote troubleshooting, the issue that caused them to lower Starship 24 back down, they gave it another go. This time, the stacking process was successful and Starship was integrated on top of Booster 7, marking yet another milestone for SpaceX as we approach the historic orbital test flight. The next steps after this will be to conduct system validation to ensure that all the electronics, valves, and critical systems are working as intended. This will now likely happen on April 10th to 12th. It is yet to be seen if SpaceX will conduct a full stack wet dress rehearsal, as they have technically already completed these steps on the booster and Starship individually. And this, of course, is not all that's happened at Starbase. Around 10 a.m. on Saturday, March 25th, a Starlink PES dispenser contraption was lowered into the Ship 26 payload bay section. The naked Starship is getting payload capabilities. Chief captured this amazing footage as workers carefully positioned the Starlink PES dispenser into position. The ingenious payload dispenser will allow up to 54 of these 1.25 ton V2 Starlink satellites to be stacked on each other. Then they will be deployed individually through a slim slot on the side of Starship, just like the candy dispensing toy. The V2 Starlings are much larger and more capable than their predecessors, making them too heavy for Falcon 9 rockets to launch in batches. They incorporate advanced technology, such as higher throughput and power efficiency, to provide more comprehensive global coverage. This approach is an entirely new way of deploying payloads compared to traditional methods used by existing rockets. If this strategy can be successfully implemented, it will reduce the launch cost and enhance the overall efficiency of the Starlink satellite constellation in orbit. To sum it all up, SpaceX continues to get closer and closer to the inaugural launch of Starship. At the launch site, the primary objective will be to run system validation checks on the fully integrated Starship over the next few days. Teams are working 24/7 around the clock to move forward with validation and, of course, obtaining that all-important FAA launch license. The excitement is building as we could be within days of witnessing history. Hype. That said, now is the time to hit that like button, subscribe, or even become an active supporter and get behind the scenes access by becoming a patron or a channel member so you don't miss any important updates. Thank you so much for your support. On we go with Astrolab. On March 31st, a company named Astrolab signed an agreement with SpaceX to send its first rover to the moon on a future Starship flight. Their website states, Flex will be the largest and most capable rover to ever operate on the lunar surface. We're not going alone. Flex will carry with it up to 1500 kilograms of commercial customer cargo, instruments, and experiments. Astrolab has not disclosed the specific customers for the mission, but the company said they have a wide range of applications that Flex will be used for. The mission will be the first flight of the Flex rover, and it will be landing with Starship in the south polar region of the moon. Plans are to start using Flex by astronauts on missions starting with Artemis V in the mid to late 2020s. Astrolab's Flex rover will be a very important component of NASA's Artemis program. The last lunar rover was used during the Apollo 17 mission in 1972. Named the Lunar Roving Vehicle, or LRV for short, it was developed to help astronauts cover more ground during their missions. The LVR had four wheels, just like a traditional car, two batteries, and brace yourselves for this, a top speed of a whopping 10 miles per hour. That's almost as fast as a marathon runner on a good day. Compared to the LVR used during the Apollo days, Flex is significantly larger and more capable. Flex will be capable of carrying 1500 kilograms or 3,307 pounds in just cargo, instruments, and experiments. It will be capable of remote operation operated from Earth. So even if the astronauts have to leave again, Flex can keep working, helping to build infrastructure and setting up experiments while no one is home. Thanks for the follow, Astrolab. Congratulations on the recent announcement at Lunam. On we go with Artemis and some real NASA heroes. The big day is here. NASA and the Canadian Space Agency have officially announced the first four astronauts that will venture around the moon on Artemis II. Victor Govert, Jeremy Hansen, Reed Wiseman, for Christina Koch, they will represent humanity together as we take the next giant leap.
We're never going to stop exploring the unknown in air and space. We're not going to stop innovating for the benefit of humanity.
We've met two of them before. Both very inspiring personalities, NASA made the right choice. They will work together to execute various test demonstrations during the approximately 10-day flight around the moon. This will be a full-blown stress test of the Orion capsule to prove out its life support system for future missions. NASA Administrator Bill Nelson himself expressed his excitement for the mission and praised the crew, stating that they represent humanity's creed and are ushering in a new era of exploration for the Artemis generation. With the announcement of the crew, NASA and the Canadian Space Agency are one step closer to realizing their mission of establishing a long-term presence on the Moon for exploration and scientific research. The Artemis II mission will continue to build upon the successful 1.4 million mile uncrewed Artemis 1 flight test that launched on November 15, 2022 and splashed down on December 11, 2022. This mission, consisting of four astronauts, will set the stage for the first woman and person of color to leave Earth's orbit, paving the way for future long-term human exploration missions to the Moon, Mars, and out amongst the stars. The strides made in the world of space exploration over the past week have been nothing short of inspiring. Incredible times to be alive. If you're planning to inspire people around you, today's sponsor might be what you're looking for. This episode is sponsored by Squarespace, your powerful one-stop tool to connect with your audience and generate revenue through gated members-only content. Manage your members, send email communications, and leverage audience insights. Extend Squarespace's already powerful e-commerce capabilities with Squarespace extensions. Manage inventory, promote products, streamline bookkeeping, reconcile and file sales tax, ship products all around the globe. Display posts from social profiles on your own website and automatically push website content to your favorite social media channels for your followers to share further. Go to squarespace.com for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/whataboutit to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. That's it for today. Remember to like and subscribe, check out our merch store to beef up your space nerd wardrobe. Crazy stuff and absolutely worth a visit. And if you want to get even smarter about space and rockets, watch this video next to continue the journey. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you again on the next episode. This is an oxygen flow. The excitement is building. On the rocket are performing nominal. I just said it. Here's to you, John Innsbrucker.